Hey everybody, this is Theo Fleury.
Hey, this is Kris Versteeg.
You're listening to the boys at Missin Curfew. When he was a kid, he'd be up at five. Take shots too late and make the thing dry. Out of the school and back on ice. That was his life. He was gonna play.
Welcome to a special episode of Missin Curfew. I'm Shane O'Brien.
And I'm your co-host right here beside you, Scotty Upshaw. How are you?
I'm good, Updog. I'm good, fella. You got the can of hockey tarp on.
Looks fuck, good. She's a little tight, eh?
Oh, it looks good on you. I'll put it on. I'll show you it looks tight.
Fuck, I actually worked out yesterday, so I might feel like I get a little juice going.
You got the nips going, too. You're good to go.
Yeah, icy nips.
Updog, this is Friday morning in the studio here with you, and you know, it's something that me and you have been talking about, I don't know, for probably 6 months or maybe longer about, you know, we're both very proud Canadians. We haven't agreed with everything that's gone on back home, and we wanted to take the opportunity to bring a couple guys on to talk about it. You know, we want to bring the country together. We're proud to be Canadian. It's not about the vaccines and all this stuff. It's just about getting Canada back to the way that we grew up with it. The kids, which I know means a lot to you, and my two nephews are living there. It means a lot to me. It's just, it's not about diverse. It's not about bringing people. It's about bringing people together, right?
I would agree. I think, Shane, we have a platform here with a lot of people that, you know, they may or may not agree with us, but we have, you know, some very loyal listeners that we love and that we love talking to you guys every week. And we hope that, you know, this message from these two individuals that we're going to bring on today, you know, and the history of them and what they've been through and the accolades in hockey, what they've both been through, the mental health and as parents. And when I think about this, and we talked about maybe doing this interview today, Obes, I did think about my nieces who are up there. I have three nieces, and, you know, I thought about my brother and his wife and my parents and, you know, people coast to coast in Canada who've quite haven't been, you know, living the way they've used to and a little different than us down here in Southern California, and across, you know, and across the US per se in some certain areas. And I wanted to voice my opinion on what I think can help, you know, a moment in time where people can speak their mind. People can talk about, you know, family and mental health and what it means to be Canadian. And to me, Obi, this week, what I've seen in Canada with, you know, with this truckers, and we're going to dive into this with our guests, but, you know, this Convoy for Freedom thing, and call it what it is. I think it's a special moment where Canadians are just coming together to do, to protest in a very peaceful way. Mm-hmm. There might be some people that, you know, there's always the oddball, but we hope things are done in the right way. And yeah, it sends a message of
violence,
of unity in Canada, of the flag, of what it meant for me to wear a C for a World Junior team and to wear the jersey, which I got here at the Spengler Cup, to wear that and wear it proud and to finally get a gold medal and what that means to me as a young Canadian kid. And I think about the young Canadian athletes, and this message is for them. And I hope this kind of brings awareness to, you know, what these kids are going through and how I think, you know, things hopefully can get better for everybody one day.
Oh, but you just used two words there, be Canadian. And when I was home for Christmas, it didn't feel like Canada. And it didn't feel like it always used to feel to me as a proud Canadian that, I don't know, it just, it really hurt me, you know, deep inside. And I have two beautiful nephews. My mom and dad are still there. Actually, happy birthday to Pitter.
Pitter's birthday.
75 today. Happy birthday, Pitter.
Fucking rights, Pitter.
You old bastard. You made her to 75.
75.
I called him this morning and I said, hey, happy birthday. I said, when you woke up at 36 years old, hung to the gills after a 3-week bender, did you think you'd make it to 75? So happy birthday, Dad. Uppy, we love the country. I miss it, you know. A couple years ago before this, I thought about moving back. I missed it so much, you know. And it's just, there's so many good people up there. And I just think we've lost, you know, we've lost that, you know, be Canadian kind of thing. So that this is all this is about. You know, we're both proud guys, proud Canadians. We want, you know, we want it to get back to the way it should be, the way we were lucky enough to grow up. Turn us into who we are.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much what this is about, right?
This isn't about politics. This to me is about freedom of Canadian people and the unity of them, whether they're on the left or the right, figuring out how to get this, how to get kids living the way they should so mental health doesn't become a thing forever. To me, that's the most important thing. And this is where my message of this comes from. And I hope that's what is taken out of this context of this, Obes, and what our guests talk about. We might have some really strong views of I bet people have strong views, and by rights they do. And we have a platform, Obi, as two Canadian guys to speak freely. And you know, we hope this message is delivered without any sort of, you know, political take on either side. It's just, let's be Canadian.
It's all for the red and white, up dog. Well said, Theo Fleury. Welcome back to Missin Curfew. Up dog, we got an absolute NHL legend, a guy that, you know, we saw last week come out and on Fox News and you know, stick up for Canada. And, you know, like we said in our intro, me and you, we love Canada. And this guy's represented the country. He's won a gold medal. He loves Canada too. And the reason we're doing this is because we all love Canada.
Absolutely.
And we don't like what's going on right now. But Theo Fleury. Theo, thank you for taking time out of your day to come on Missin Curfew. Like I said, me and Uppy saw you on Fox News. I loved what you said. I agreed with everything you said. Me and Uppy have been talking about this for the last 6 months on here.
At least
about what's been going on. And so thank you for joining us.
Yeah, appreciate the opportunity always to talk about whatever. So,
yeah,
you know, that's what I spent most of my day doing. You know, and it's really great that, you know, former players are, you know, doing this kind of stuff. I think it's really important. And, you know, it's you know, I love talking hockey. You know, everything I have in my life has come from the game of hockey. And, you know, I'm very grateful. And, you know, the era that I played in was, I believe, the greatest era of hockey. The greatest amount of superstars, you know, in the game, and, you know, the leadership from that era was, you know, second to none. You know, the Messiers, the Gretzkys, the Marios, the Sakics, the Eisermans, you know, I got a chance to hang out with those guys and observe and watch how they led. And you know, now that my post-career, you know, I've led a lot of different things in my life, and you know, I try to act the way that those guys did. You know, they were very humble. They made everybody feel important, you know, from the guy that made coffee in the morning to, you know, to the guys that they played on the same line. And it was really cool to be around those guys and just learn and observe and learn, you know?
Yeah, I'd agree. I'd say, you know, Shane and I came in, Theo, probably towards the latter part of your career, 2002, 2003, 2004. Mm-hmm. And the things you learn from older guys that you played with are things that we carry on, you know, with our kids and, you know, the way we treat other people, our trainers, you know, the way you take criticism from your coach, you know, and how you got to, you know, keep your chin high and work harder. And so all those things. And we hope that, you know, the kids that we played with are doing the same thing. You know, and now that we're going through this phase of our life, a very odd time, a very challenging time, I think about kids. I think about the minor hockey kids in Canada. I think about my nieces back home who are held back from, you know, being normal, having fun with their friends, not going to dance class, not being able to, you know, getting shut down for certain things. And I guess if you could just enlighten us and our listeners on where you've been in your space the last little bit, why you've spoke up and been a patriot for Canada. I'm wearing my Canada t-shirt today. I'm fucking very, very proud right now to be Canadian, more than ever in the last couple of years. Could you touch on this convoy, on people actually standing up and supporting Canada in a very honest and non-threatening, non-violent way, but it's time that they're speaking up, and this is great.
Yeah. So, you know, I was not much into politics, you know, and, you know, I don't think I voted ever until I was done my hockey career. And I didn't know if I was a liberal, a conservative, a patriot, a libertarian, you know, anything. And so, you know, in 2015, Trump comes strolling down the escalator and announces he's going to be, you know, he's running for president of the United States. And I was like, that's really strange, you know, because I had the opportunity playing in New York to meet him a few times, you know, and really, you know, he's a guy's guy. Like, he could walk into any NHL dressing room and fit right in. He's that kind of guy, you know. First time I met him, he shook my hand, looked me fucking straight in the eye, and, you know, was asked me about my family. And I just thought he was kind of a cool guy, right? So I'm like, why is this guy running to be the president of the United States? So I started following politics, right? And, of course, you know, I went to where everybody goes for their politics at that time, which was CNN. Right. So I started watching CNN and I'm like, something's just not right here, you know? So then I started watching Fox and then I was like, okay, I get it. Fox is right. CNN's left. Right. And so, and I was more attracted to, you know, the right side, you know, the patriotic, freedom loving, you know, all these things. And so I realized that I was a patriot, that I like my freedom. I like freedom of choice. I don't want government meddling in any aspect of my life. I'm very capable of, you know, and I also grew up in Western Canada, right? And in Western Canada, all we know how to do is work, right?
Yeah.
We know how to work, right? And it's at the core of everything we do, right? And then all of a sudden, you know, all of these climate activists came and, you know, and, you know, when I got to Calgary, there was only 550,000 people in Calgary. Now there's close to 1.3 million people that live in Calgary. Why did everybody come to Calgary? Because of oil and gas, right? There's jobs, there's opportunity, all that stuff. And, you know, I was downtown the other day and 70% of the office space in Calgary is empty. And so you go downtown Calgary, it's a ghost town. Like, it's really, really, really sad. And this is a direct result of having a liberal government for 6 years. This is the direct result of having a liberal government and their policies and, you know, all that. Right. So, so then, you know, the virus hits and 2 weeks to flatten the curve. Right. So I went along with that because we didn't know anything. We didn't have any information. We didn't know nothing. So 2 weeks becomes 6 weeks and 6 weeks becomes a year. And then a year becomes 2 years. Right. And then all this information starts coming in. Right. But it's only a one-sided opinion of what's going on. So the Dr. McCulloughs, the Dr. Malones, the Joe Rogans of the world are being heavily censored. And I'm like, so who's telling the truth? The guys that are getting censored are the ones that are telling the truth, right? And what you're talking about with the kids is a little thing that I like to call abuse. It's abuse. Abuse at the highest levels of government, right? And everybody's very familiar with my story because I came out with my story in 2009. I talked about my trauma. Okay. And so all of this has been done by design, right? Mm-hmm. And this type of ideology has been tried 24 times in the history of our planet. Globalism, communism, you know, whatever you want to call it, has been tried 24 times. And it's failed every single time. It's failed. And the only byproduct of this type of ideology is what? Death. That's the only byproduct that comes out of this ideology is death. And what are we seeing? People are dying left, right, and center. People are being injured by the vaccines, you know, all this stuff, right? And so I said to myself, if I saw abuse ever again in my life, I was going to call it out. I was going to call it out. And, you know, that's what I've been doing. I've been calling out abuse. That's it, right? And, you know, I mentioned earlier when we were talking that, you know, I'm a guy that spent $1 million on therapy. I've done 10,000 hours of therapy. I do therapy with other people now, and I run groups talking about trauma, mental health, and addiction. And why have we seen a spike in mental illness? Why have we seen a spike in opioid use? Why have we seen a spike in opioid deaths? Why have we seen a spike in suicidal ideation? Why have we seen a spike in suicides? Is because they have taken out relationship. They closed the ranks. They closed the churches. They locked us up. And as a guy who suffers from mental health challenges, where's the worst place for me to be when I have a mental illness?
Alone.
Alone at home.
Yeah.
Alone and stuck inside of my own head.
Yeah.
Right? So that's why we've seen a significant increase in all these categories.
And that's, Theo, that's so true. And I went over and played in Finland. This is for 3 months. But anyways, there was no North Americans. I was in a small town. I was stuck in my apartment, and I never battled mental, like, by the end of that 3 months, Theo, I was depressed. I was lonely. I never had that feeling in my life of being so lonely and alone and sitting in my apartment in Finland. So I know exactly what you mean. Like, I'd never been in that dark of a place.
Yeah. Yeah. Because when we're alone, we're, you know, we're left to deal with, you know, our stuff.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, I played in Finland during the lockout in 94, and fucking dark at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It was a grind.
And, you know, Finland has one of the highest places in the world for alcoholics. Right. Because, so I'll explain to you how this is all connected.
Yeah.
So when we're kids, we get traumatized, right? Doesn't have to be as extreme as my story. It could be as simple as my parents divorced. I was bullied in school, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And trauma is very subtle. And a lot of times you don't know, or you don't even know that you've experienced trauma in your life. And so what happens is that trauma leaves you in emotional pain and suffering. Any kind of emotional pain and suffering is what? Mental illness. Okay. So how do we deal with this emotional pain and these scars that are left behind from these traumatic experiences? Well, we tend to gravitate towards the dark side of life, and we get involved in addictions as a coping mechanism to suppress the emotional pain and suffering. And in society, because we're so afraid of being judged, we internalize all this stuff because I have nowhere to go and talk about how I was raped 150 times by my coach. There's no space in society that is acceptable, right?
Yeah.
And so if we got nowhere to talk about it, we internalize it. And when we internalize it, what happens?
Just eats at you.
Our nervous system gets completely fucked up. Because when we're under high states of stress, we produce a chemical in our body called cortisol. And cortisol is like acid in our system. And so what happens when you're living in a high state of stress, the cortisol starts to eat away at your nervous system and starts to fray those nerves, right? And the only way that we can recover and repair all of that damage is in relationship, right? We need relationships where I can share the deepest, darkest secrets of my life, right?
Yeah.
But I have to feel safe in those spaces, in those environments, right? And so, you know, and in the hockey world, we never use this word ever. Little word called vulnerability.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Vulnerability is storytelling. Vulnerability is storytelling. And when we are vulnerable, you know what happens? It creates safety. And then when we have safety in the room, that's when the magic of healing happens, is when people feel safe, heard, listened to, believed, not judged, all those things, right? And so that's why we've seen such a spike in people who are struggling mentally, is because we haven't created that space in society where we can go and talk about this stuff. So yeah. I've spent the last 15 years trying to create this space for all of this trauma that's happening in the world.
Yeah. Yeah. And you've done an incredible job, Theo.
Yeah.
Coming out and your book and what you've been doing and leading these talks. And there's been a lot of athletes that Shane and I have known that have gone through, you know, some really hard times, and they would say the same thing. You need the family, you need the space, you need to be able to talk. It's
so true. And I played with a guy, Rick Rippon, and you know, Ripper, 10 years, it was, you know, yesterday, the anniversary of us passing, I believe. And we still do the bell, let's talk. And Theo, I remember the first year we were both living in the hotel, and I come back from practice and you have the do not disturb on this door all day. And I'd be like, fuck, what the fuck is going on? Right. Then I got to know him. And so I saw him battle it. I saw him his second year get through it. And then I saw him fall back into it. And at that time, he was a tough guy that, you know, obviously wasn't that tough inside. And like you said, you don't want to be vulnerable in the NHL, especially if you're a tough guy. And I just look back to be like, man, if someone could have talked to him more and reached out. And nowadays, because of guys like you, I think it probably would have saved Ripper, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So Theo, let me just, so part of, I want to say this, but part of healing right now for Canadians, I'm seeing, I don't watch the news. I don't watch mainstream news. And unfortunately in Canada, a lot of people are watching one-sided news. It's really all they have up there. And that's what I know from a distance. I'm very lucky to be here and living, what I would say is the most normal of a life here in Southern California with coming to work with my partners here and our guys doing work. And I don't see it firsthand, but I feel it up there. I feel the tension with Canada, and I feel the love of everyone. And what I've seen and, you know, Mike Fisher coming out the other day and the little video, he's from Ottawa. I played with him World Championships. Very stand-up guy. And if none of you think so, then you're fucking nuts.
I played with Fish. You won't find a better
guy. You won't find a better guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he said he'd been following this for a while, and he's starting to see the love, and he's starting to see the courage of Canadians. And like I said, I think this can be accomplished in a very, non-violent way, not what people might think happened down here in the U.S. Canada.
Well, it's coming. It's coming to you guys.
Yeah.
What's happening in Canada is going to happen in the United States for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. But how I see it, and I'll use a hockey analogy to sort of explain what's going on. So for 2 years, Canada has been in a deep, dark depression, okay? And so what happens every time there's a big hockey tournament that Canada's involved in?
It gets fucking canceled.
Nope. We grab our jersey, we grab our flag, and we sit in front of our TV for 2 weeks and we live and die with our team.
Yeah, okay? 100%. Yeah.
So who's Team Canada right now? The truckers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And what has happened? The truckers initiated this big event. And now what are you seeing? You're seeing people from all over Canada grabbing their red coat jersey, whatever it is, grabbing their flag, and they're coming out of their house and they're standing on the street and they're supporting these truckers, right?
Theo,
that to me is Canada.
Yeah.
That's Canada, right? That's what we grew up with. Fucking World Junior every Christmas, Olympics, yeah. World Cups. Like that's what this is, but it's 100x now.
Yeah, I agree.
Because it's like the whole country is rallying around these truckers.
Theo, what would you say to the people who would be reading the news and thinking that this is just some anti-vax weird movement, you know, with that labeled to what this actually really is? This is
the narrative. The narrative's done.
Yeah.
Okay. The narrative is over. Vaccine mandates, get vaccinated, you know, stay in your house. All this stuff is gone. The narrative has been blown up and people, I said, that's it. I had enough. Yeah. Enough is enough.
And
you've had two years to figure this out. And we are not going to vaccinate our way out of this.
Yeah.
We're not going to vaccinate our way out of it.
And Theo, and that's where I get pissed off as a Canadian is I think, listen, at the start of COVID, I think we could all agree to a certain extent. It was scary.
Yeah.
I was scared.
Yeah.
I didn't know what the fuck was going on.
Of course.
And I think the Canadian people, and this is a credit to us, the government said, hey, listen, stay in your house. We don't know what's going on. They followed the rules and followed the rules. And Theo, I guess my question to you is, do you think the government then went, wow, okay, these people will listen to pretty much anything we'll fucking say, and we're going to continue. In my mind, that's what they did, and that's what pisses me off, is they took advantage of how good Canadian people are, and some people are still scared and brainwashed, Theo, to, you know, my parents are the two best parents in the world, and they're older, they're vaccinated, and they're scared to travel still because of what they're being told. They're the nicest people in the world. Like, that to me is what makes me mad. I think they took advantage of the Canadian people.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Yeah. Well, do you agree? One stat in all of this that really stands out to me is that if you get COVID, you have a 99.7% chance of survival.
Yeah.
99.7% chance of
there was a couple survival. Nights. There was a couple nights I went out on the road during my career. I didn't have that percentage of making it out alive, man.
Holy fuck, you're talking.
How do I take those chances?
Yeah, no Missin shit,
curfew?
Theo.
Curfew? That's my fucking middle name.
Oh, you probably did. Yeah, you did it the best, I'm sure. Holy fuck. Jeez, Theo.
So, this Theo, what's it like for, and I know you don't see me, but like right now, if you go out or in your media, like what is the reaction you're getting from people in Canada? Because you're an icon for obviously what you did on and off the ice. Are you feeling more people are like the people out supporting the truckers now, or is it still split? What's the feeling back home right now?
This is the greatest event in Canadian history. The biggest thing that's ever happened in Canada right now. Right now, this is it, right? And, you know, the Bible predicted this, right? This is the last fight of good versus evil. This is it. If we lose, it's over. It's over. It is over, right? They're going to be coming and dragging us out of our houses, taking us to concentration camps and forced vaccination on everybody. You know, and I don't want to get into this conspiracy, but I think it needs to be said, is that there's a guy who runs the world, the World Economic Forum. His name is Klaus Schwab, and he wrote a book called The Great Reset. And the tagline that came out of that book is, you will own nothing and you will be happy. That's their tagline. And so there was a video that just came out of Klaus Schwab being interviewed, where he basically said, we own Justin Trudeau and we own half of his cabinet members in Canada. So the World Economic Forum has infiltrated our government. And this is the reason why we're at the place that we're at right now. Okay. And so, you know, at the end of the day, God wins, in my belief, you know, faith has been the only thing that saved my life. You know, I'm not a God, you know, I'm a spiritual guy, right? And, you know, in the last 15 years, I've been able to travel to 420 of the 630 First Nations communities in Canada, helping them with their own traumatic experience, the residential school experience, right? Mm-hmm. And that trickle down effect that it's had on their whole entire community. But more importantly, what's happened is those people saved my life. Those people say, why? Because they have the greatest untapped resource of medicine on the planet. On the planet. And it's a little thing called spirituality. And I can tell you, 5 years into my own sobriety, like I hit a wall and I was like, this is what sobriety is all about. Then I don't want any fucking part of it. I might as well go back drinking because I'm acting like, you know, I'm acting like one, but I'm not drinking.
Yeah, I'm
angry, resentful, you know, all these things. And so I went to my first sweat lodge around that time and I sat in the sweat lodge. And I had a spirit, like I had another spiritual awakening, and I finally felt home. I finally felt like I was at home. I felt that I fully understood what spirituality was all about, you know. Yeah. And you know, I sweat with one of the most powerful medicine men in the world down in Cardston, Alberta, a couple hours from my house, and I got COVID. And so I called him and I said, hey, Arnold, I need some medicine. And he drove up and dropped off some medicine. I took four doses of his medicine and I was good to go. And so I have a really special place in my heart for the Indigenous community in Canada.
Yeah.
And when this is all said and done, you know, I'm going to be a big proponent of their medicine. As to use their medicine to heal from, you know, this traumatic experience that we've gone through for the last 2 years, because I really believe they have what we need.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, Theo, man, we really appreciate you coming on. You know, we'd love to have you on again to talk some more hockey stuff and other stuff like that. You're a legend. We look up to you. Obviously, we love the way you played, but everything you've been through off the ice, man. And thanks for being a proud Canadian and coming on and talking. And we're with you, fella. We're with you. And,
yeah.
At the end of the day, we all love Canada, right? And that's all we really care about, man. We all love Canada.
It's the greatest country in the world.
Exactly.
The greatest country in the world with diversity. You know, the reason why I chose to live in Calgary post-career is because I love this community, you know? I love Alberta in general.
Yeah.
You know, it's the greatest amount of charity that I've ever been around, you know? And when we're done post-career, you know, we usually get involved with some sort of charity or group or whatever it is. And you know, when I first came to Calgary, not only were you expected to be a good hockey player for the organization, but you were expected to be a part of the community. And they made us do charity work, go to events, get out there, meet the people that are paying your salary, right?
Exactly.
You know, and I think that's gotten lost, is that these kids have no idea that the people who go to the games in Edmonton and Calgary, four people come to a game. That's that guy's salary.
Yeah.
For 2 weeks.
No kidding.
For 2 weeks. Right. And I don't think the kids fully understand that without the fans, there is no you. There is no you.
Yeah.
Right. And so, yeah, you know, I think that as former players and celebrities, you know, we have a duty to give back, right? We have a duty to give back. And in the process of healing, that is the most important thing in healing, is helping is healing. Yeah. Because the more people I've helped, guess what's happened? I've been able to heal myself by helping other people, right? And so that charity aspect of my life is probably the biggest reason why I'm still alive today, is because I've been able to take people where I used to be and take them to the place where I am now, right? And that's ultimately, you know, purpose, right? You know, I always thought my purpose was to be an NHL player. Well, no, that wasn't it. Hockey's just the game. And, you know, when I told my story in 2009, I got an opportunity to step into my true purpose in life. And there was a reason why I went through all that trauma, was to get to this place where I could step into my purpose. Because if I didn't have this story, I can't help people.
Yeah. Yeah. Right? Yeah, of course.
So the gift actually was the trauma in my life. You know, my parents, my abuser, those guys were gifts in my life because I had to go through adversity to build resilience. And when you have resilience, you can get through anything, right?
Yeah.
And so what's happening now with COVID is it's adversity. And that adversity is building resilience in people, right?
Yeah.
And coming out of this, I think it's going to be amazing.
Yeah, I really do.
I agree with that. We're going to come out stronger up there. Everywhere, everyone's going to come out stronger. So,
yeah.
Theo, you're the man, buddy. We appreciate it. Like you said, we'd love to have you back on.
Yeah, anytime.
Yeah,
anytime. I'm just fucking sitting in my house, fucking locked up. So I got lots of time.
We really appreciate it. Yeah,
the golf courses are closed. I'm jealous you guys are in California because I would be. Like, I've played 280 rounds of golf in 2 years.
Wow.
Because I'm at the course every day.
Yeah, that's pretty good. That's your escape right there. Fucking right.
What's that?
That's your escape. Get to the course.
That's my Paxil, my Prozac, my my mental health.
Yeah.
You know?
How's the game?
Pretty good.
Not a book. Yeah. Fuck, well, we got to team up.
You know, with athletes, you know, we've kind of have OCD, right? And I'm the same with golf. Like, I'll get up in the morning and I'll go to the course and I'll hit balls for like 2 or 3 hours.
Wow.
And then I'll wait for my kids and my dad, and we'll tee off like 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I'll play around. And then if I don't play well, I'll go back to the range and I'll hit more balls, right? Because golf is about repetition. Golf is about, you know, and the thing about golf is if you're not mentally focused in golf, it's a shit show. Right? You know what I mean?
You can get away playing hockey, just not too focused.
I gotta keep my boy off. When he's my partner, I gotta keep him off his cell phone, Theo. He's on his phone the whole fucking round. I'm like, up, dog, get off that phone. I need you here.
We're playing for hundreds here.
Well, at our course, cell phones don't work.
Oh, that's where I got to kick up dog. That's where I got to take the up dog.
Yeah,
that's good.
He's a stick, Theo. He's a scratch. But if you can get him on the phone or talking
then
about,
you might get in my pocket.
You might get in his pocket.
That's when you get the full press is when you start fucking around on your phone.
Exactly. If you see him on his phone, throw a press at him, Theo.
Yeah, exactly. For sure. For sure.
I appreciate
the opportunity.
It's a big day tomorrow.
Thank you, buddy.
Thanks for reaching out and fucking pray hard for tomorrow that shit doesn't go down. Shit doesn't go sideways. I'm hearing all reports is there some fucking characters that are going to show up and try and cause shit tomorrow. So,
yeah. Well, I hope that doesn't happen. We don't need that, but like you said, Theo, you know, the last couple of days seeing that, you know, maple leaf with the red and white. It's good to see again because, you know, me and Uppy, we know down here, we still miss home and it's good to see. So hopefully we don't want any violence, but I'm glad to see the Canadian flags back out, fella.
Yeah, all the messaging from the truckers has been, this is a peaceful protest. We're not here to cause shit. You know, we just want our freedom back. That's it. Yeah. We want the mandates gone. We want the masks gone. We want the vaccine gone. We just want our freedoms back and we want to get back to, you know, the Canadian way of life, and that's working hard and providing for our families and you know, going back to the arenas and getting back into church and, yeah, you know, yeah, bringing that sense of community back to Canada, because, you know, there's a reason why there's a rink in every small town in Canada, is because that's where we go.
That's the church. Yeah.
That's where we go to get all of these amazing lessons that
in life
that we've, you know, that we carry with us for the rest of our life. Right. Cause we don't put our kids in sports to create professional athletes. We put our kids in sports to create quality human beings.
Yeah.
Right.
Well said.
And you know, the three of us, you know, went to the church of hockey and learned some incredible, valuable lessons in our life that made us good people, you know, yeah, made us quality people, you know, and we need to get back to that.
Well said, Theo. That's a perfect way to end it, buddy. We appreciate you. Loved watching you play, fella. I wish I would have played. I gotta be honest with you. I wish I would have played with you back in the day. I'm not gonna lie. I wish I would have played with you back in the day.
Yeah. I caught you in your. I played with you against you in my first season. So I'll always cherish that. You're a hawk. Fucking
did you get
still
a,
buzzing
did you get
around.
A little fucking stick.
I got
in
a
ribs?
Stick probably in the
for
nuts
sure.
And a minus one. I'm sure if I look in the Nashville Hawks game, I was a dash one or two playing against you, my friend.
Well, people always ask me, they go, what was it like to play in your era? I said, I played in the era when you were slashing somebody, you hope you hit bone.
That's hockey, yeah. Dude, you slash him and you know you got him on the bone. You're like, oh, yeah, I got him good there. I got him good there.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Theo. Thank you, buddy.
Big fella, our next guest is one of my teammates. I actually got the Spangy Cup jersey behind me. Look at that. Fucking Canada. I got the t-shirt on.
You look great.
Thanks. Our boy, Kris Versteeg, thanks for dialing in Toronto. You look like you're sitting or laying on that nice restoration hardware bed there. Nice little workbench.
I'm comfy right now. I'm getting ready to go here. So I had to get on the bed. I don't even have an office anymore, nothing. You know, kids have taken all that away. So this is where I work, you know, all day is on the bed. Yeah,
I'm good. I used to work a lot in the bed, eh? I wish. Jeez, back in the day, that was showtime back then. Steger, I wanted to bring you on. It's today is all about Canada for Shane and I. For I hope our listeners, the message we're trying to say is we love Canada, and in a long, long time, I haven't been so proud to say I'm Canadian. What I seen you do yesterday on your Instagram, I wanted to bring you in and share some of those stories. And you've been up in Canada for the last little while, Steger. So just, you know, your experiences, your thoughts, and, you know, watching this movement of, you know, people standing up for their flag, for their freedom, for their kids, just what that means to you and your family.
Well, it's first off for you guys covering this, it's a testament to you because you're a hockey podcast and you're covering real world issues right now. So thanks for doing that. I know me, I just, before I get into it, when I talk to Sportsnet or I talk to, this is a pretty open thing I'm going to say right here. When I talk to XM radio, I just said, I don't talk politics. I'm not a political guy. Don't ask me political questions. I don't give a shit about Rob Ford or Stephen DeLuca or Andre Horvath, these people, these clowns, right? I don't care about them. I don't want to answer them on the radio. I want nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
So where this has gone for me is I went 2 years saying nothing, right? Saying nothing. And you watch your kids, you know, sit inside basically for 2 years. They're not allowed to be with their friends. Over those 2 years, you start to understand things more and more about what's going on. But at that same time, you start to see what's happening to your kids and kids around you, right? So you start to think about it, like what's going on here in Canada that's not going on elsewhere, right? And I start to reach out to friends in the States. I reach out to friends in Minnesota. He runs a hockey school and they're playing hockey the entire time. You know, basically they shut down for a month, but they kept playing all the way through. And I reach out to friends in Chicago and they're finding ways to keep kids active. And as we keep going on, it kind of leads us up to about 2 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago now, when they shut us down. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? They just locked us down again, right? And I have my kid in the back seat and he's like, Daddy, when am I going to go to hockey? You know, why can't I go to hockey? Why can't I be with my friends? Now, I'm not trying to make anyone feel sorry for me, but that pissed me off finally. You know, I'm like, if I'm going to stick my neck out on the line and talk about some politics, I'm going to take a lot of heat and take a lot of flack over the next probably half hour and however much for saying this. But I'm like, I got to stick up for my children, you know, and it's about us sticking up for our children now, because what's going on in Canada and in Ontario is despicable. And what I can't understand is you just see these politicians now and none of them have their own thoughts, you know, none of them create their own thoughts and talk about what's truly honest, you know, what's truly honest and means well to them. They only talk about who's lobbied them the most, right?
Yeah.
Whether it's Andrea Horwath or whether it's the Stephen DeLuca clown and Rob Ford, they only dictate policy based on who's lobbied them the most. And this has been the most evident thing over the past 2 years. This has been gone way by the wayside. Is when has Doug Ford talked about vitamin D deficiency, right? In COVID patients or obesity or people take your vitamins, exactly. Exercise, get healthy. You watched El Salvador released a video about health and wellness, getting people healthy, because that's a good way to help fight COVID, right? And I'm not a doctor. I'm not telling you how to fight COVID, but these are things that governments around the world are doing, except our own still here in Canada. So this finally, back to 4 weeks ago, I kind of said, fuck it. I just got to say something now because I can't stay quiet anymore. I've been quiet forever. I don't like talking politics, but now it's like, I got to say something, whether it be for myself, just to know, you know, what my kids are going through and for others out there that are in my situation, because we talk about a fringe minority, right? This is a fringe minority. Well, guess what? Wouldn't you want that fringe minority included in your society? There's bad people in it, right? And that's what they're trying to make this thing about right now. But most of the fringe minority are good law-abiding citizens, people that pay their taxes. They go to work every day. They put their fucking head down. They grind. Wouldn't you want these people part of your society, vaccinated or unvaccinated?
Like, agreed, yeah.
Wouldn't you want to include them as part of your life, right? That's where I just don't understand anymore, like, where this has gone and where it's gone off the rails. But for me, it just comes back to, these politicians don't have a real thought. They don't have a real human element to them. They can't feel human elements anymore because they've had to make so much lobbying policies over the last 2 years that they're not human anymore. Like, they can't actually come to us and have like a conversation person to person and feel what these people are feeling because the situations and the decisions they have to make on a daily basis, right? It's because there's like, could you imagine making some of the decisions they have to make, but they have to make them. And they're just doing it whoever's lining their pockets the most. So this is where it's just gone completely off the rails. And I finally said, fuck it. I'm saying something.
And I want to say something, Steger. I was home for about 2 weeks over Christmas. And the thing that really got to me was, you know, and media is media, but like every time I would watch it with my dad and, you know, it would just be the one thing, like the way they are trying to brainwash Canadians up there. And like we said, me and Uppy, like COVID at the start was scary. And the thing that pisses me off the most is that Canadian people are good people that were following the rules. And then the government went, oh, okay, well, let's see how much farther they'll go and farther they'll go. And now, in my opinion, you know more than me, you live there. I just feel that they're taking advantage of the good Canadian people. And that's what pisses me off the most.
Well, it's bad, man. It's really bad. So I could, here's a story that I haven't really told anyone, even just with my son. You know what I mean? This is where I feel like the taking advantage of and the manipulation of the mind has gone a little crazy. It's like my son's a 5-year-old and at school, you don't have to wear a mask 5 and under, right? And he's one of the only kids who doesn't wear one at school. He wasn't allowed to be a part of circle time and he had to sit at his desk by himself as a 5-year-old while everyone else got to be around each other for circle time. This is my child, right?
Yeah.
So, and this is, again, it was an option to do. So I'm not blaming anyone in the sense, but is that all right?
No, it's like, not all right.
Is that okay?
No.
Like, that's not all right. And I don't care who you are or what background you have or what your belief system is, that the way this should be is we all should be together for each other. We're a country.
To unite, and, not to separate, yeah.
And yesterday, being at the convoy was like one of the most euphoric feelings I've had in like 2 years since pretty much winning the Spengler Cup with you, Uppy.
Fucking right.
It was like, It was like, I was so proud to be Canadian again.
Yeah.
I seen every walk of life there. I talked to hundreds of people, vaccinated, unvaccinated, whatever it may be, liberal, NDP, conservative. It didn't matter, right? PPC, whatever. They were all there for one reason, right? And they were there to support the people going to Ottawa to protest for their freedoms, right? It's not about just one, or I guess a vaccine or whatever. It's about your freedoms, yeah. Right? It's about what you're going to instill or give to your kids, pass on to your kids so they can think freely and they can be around one another. But I was talking to people, man. Like, there was like grown men crying. You know what I mean? It was fucking crazy. I posted one video of a guy. He started crying right after the video. You know what I mean? Like, he's a father of, I forgot how it said, but all three guys standing there were fathers. Like, I was like, this is crazy. This means so much to these people. And they're Canadians. Yeah. They all pay their taxes, right? If they're a fringe minority, it doesn't matter. Include them, right? That's where this has just gone crazy. And that Trudeau, the divisiveness that's come out of his mouth, and Rob Ford's and Stephen DeLuca, the guy who's running for Liberal Party, and all these guys, is just, it's so bad right now. It is so bad. And I know you guys had Fleury on. Like, me and Fleury, I'm sure we have a lot of varying different thoughts on policy, right? Like, again, like on just politics in general. But at the end of the day, you can sit down with someone and still discuss it. And that's where this is gone. You can't even discuss anything anymore.
Yeah, that's right? What he brought up.
Well, that's the thing that pissed me. Like, yeah, no one's talking about it. It's just up there. When I was there, it's just, this is what's happening. Like, no other message being sent across, but this. And I'm like to my friend, finally my buddies are starting to come around, but I mean, it's just, that's the one to me, I was like,
what? Well, do you think you could ever see them sitting down and having an open conversation with no script to deliver on, like, say, a live TV set? It would be almost impossible. You'd never see it nowadays.
Well, that's what you think. Like, critical thinking comes from taking basically two different decisions, deciphering them, and then making your own out of that, right? But when in Canada, we've been just told one thing for day after day, it's been telling you how to think each day, day in and day out. Like, there's no one being brought on to talk about like health or anything else, right? Like, to like challenge or push back. It's just been one way of thinking in Canada, especially day after day after day for 2 years. And I was actually, this kind of brings it back to the convoy yesterday. I didn't think I was going to see people between the age of probably 50 and 70. At the convoy, because most of those people do partake in the media, right? Yeah. Day after day, they just have it on all day. There was a ton of people in that age bracket. I was shocked. You know, I thought it was going to be more, you know, between 20 and 40 age. There was a ton of people in that age bracket. So maybe they're just tuning it out now too, because they've been just force fed this information day after day.
Yeah. Another thing that made me mad is my mom and dad have been locked down for 2 years, and all they wanted to do was have Christmas Eve over at their house with their friends that are all vaccinated and all everything. And this new variant comes out and the Canadian media is scaring them all, and they have to cancel it and don't get to enjoy Christmas Eve with their friends. And they haven't done it in 2 years because of it. And I'm just like, that's not right.
Yeah,
like,
when's enough?
Like, my mom and dad want to spend Christmas Eve with their friends and family in a small town of 12,000 people. And they're scared to get together. You know, I was like,
and they've done their part.
They've done their part. And they can't have, you know, four or five friends over because they're all scared of COVID. I was just like, it didn't sit well with me, Steger.
No.
Yeah.
Nor should it.
Steger, we've used this, you know, our last 4 or 5 months since the season started, basically in the NHL, you know, there's been ups and downs on, you know, all the protocols and everything. And we finally got fed up with the word protocol. We started to just like, the guy, you know, unfortunately, the guy had to test. They should stop doing the testing. The guy has the sniffles. He's got to sit in his hotel room for 5 days while his team goes on the road. It's like there needs to be more common sense used at this when it's dealing with the sports and the NHL. But this, to me, like this last week, since I've followed this and since, you know, we talked about Mike Fisher coming out and he's been following it. He's in Ottawa, you know. Grew up in Ottawa, and he probably has a ton of friends and family involved in what this is as well. It's just more to it. It feels more patriotic to me. It feels more like finally Canada. You know, it takes a lot to piss off a fucking Canadian. Like, it takes a lot for Canada.
Unless the beer store is closed, then we get fucking choked.
Yeah, or your fucking team gets a bad call in the fucking, you know, in the game, and they score and they lose. You know, then you fucking hit the streets. But finally, it's like, someone stood up, you know, and Theo said it before, like these truckers, they're truckers. They fucking sit in their truck. They work hard. They're working people. But this isn't like an anti-vax thing. This is a standing up for what could be the only time that you can gather everyone who feels like things have been wrong and they can voice their message. And that yeah. the message can beat the media that is trying to just deliver one message to everyone. You know, it's finally a moment where you can come out with your family again. And I hope to God tomorrow, Saturday in Canada, everyone opens up their stores. I hope everyone goes and it's like a life happens again there. That to me would be the ultimate, to see people just stand up for their small business, stand up for their family, stand up for their kids who have to wear a mask at school and just say, guys, we're all together in this. Like now we're moving to this next place. We're getting over this.
And here's one thing we haven't really touched on. Stand up for mental health.
Yeah. Fucking
ace. That's like, all.
Yeah. Steger, that's my next question to you.
Yeah.
I know 10 people in the last year, OD and suicide, you know, yeah. or in 18 months, sorry.
Yeah.
And that's like, and they're all between 20 and 40 age, right? And like these, you take away the gym, you take away sports, you take away everything from them and you tell them to go isolate. They're in a hard place. I just lost a friend, Derek Wiest. He's my age. His uncle owns the hockey school with me. And like it's hard to say, yeah, like yeah, yeah. they've been through a ton, man. And they're alone a lot of the time, right? And there's really a crisis in help. You can't even go out and get help. Young hockey players, I know they're trying to reach out for help through because they're in a mental health breakdown. They've had hockey taken away from them, their sport taken away. Not only that, I have friends who coach and they're coaching kids that are 16, 17, 18 now. And they said a lot of the time they're just, you know, talking to crying kids in a room or sad kids in a room because of the adversity, right? So they have hockey taken away for 2 years. They come back and say if they get sad or benched or not played much that game, that's a lot of mental anguish for a kid in your teens going through that. Imagine being 16 years old, not playing for 2 years and then going and like playing in Kamloops uppy and you get sat for the first 5 games. Like, how do you deal with that adversity on top of everything else? So it's like, that's where I start to like, look, I'm like, we need to be there for these kids, man.
Yeah.
There needs to be something in these athletic kids. I know I'm only speaking of kids and athletes because I deal with them every day, but us NHL guys, us older NHL guys and everything, there's going to be an issue at hand here. And there's going to need to be something set up for these kids to talk, for us to help them, because it is a serious issue, you know? And that's where, again, it's a mental health crisis right now. And it's an issue. And I don't know what there is to do besides just keep reaching out to kids and helping, but I would love something else to be done. But I mean, yeah, it's really hard to see what they're going through, these kids, man. It sucks. And I couldn't fucking imagine being 10, 11, 12, my mom, you know, single mom raising 3 kids at home, no school, no sport. I'd be in fucking jail. I swear. You know what I mean?
It's so true, man. Like if I didn't have hockey when I was growing up, like I 14, 15, 16, they said you can't play. I don't know what would happen to me. I don't know. I mean, it would have been. Hockey was,
and that's why you have sport, right? Yeah. Obi, like,
yeah.
And that's where you look at the, so we always look at like the data of sport, right? Like most kids quit sport around 12 years old. So if most kids right now are 10 years old, sorry, leading into the pandemic and they haven't played sport in 2 years, most kids actually quit sport at 10 years old now. Right.
Yeah.
So now that takes them down 2 more years. What are they going to do during those next 2 years to fill time? Right. And who are they going to talk to? And who are the people they're going to surround themselves with? So are we going to get them back into sport when things start opening back up? Like sport is everything for people and it's a big life lesson and it's a huge thing. So I don't know what it's going to be like, but we need, like, that's where I finally said again, 4 weeks ago, I'm screw it. Open sports now. These kids need it. Kids need to go to the rink. We got to find ways. If you're only allowing one parent in the rink per kid, so be it, whatever. These kids need to be around each other and they need to play.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well said.
I agree.
Steger, what are you, I know, just on a different pace, but what talk about your new venture, your new little program you put online. What can you do to help these kids in that way?
Yeah, it was, it's a youth sport app. It's a free app. And basically what I wanted to do is bring the pro tools to the mass, right? All the current sport tech out there is built for you know, the A coach, we call it. So like for NHL coaches, for East Coast, or for like individual skill coaches that deal with NHLers. So what we wanted to do is create tech, take those type of ideas and apply it to tech that could be across all sport for all kids. And that's what we did. It's, so we took this clip button and it's buffering in the camera and you can record for 5 minutes. And if nothing happens, you swipe out and none of that's saved. But if your kid scores after 5 minutes, say, and you're recording for 5 minutes, you just tap this button. It goes back 15 seconds and deletes the first 4 minutes and 45 seconds. Because what we found is parents always have too much video. And then you can take that clip as a coach or a parent. You could share it in or out of the platform. You could pull it up into a coach mode. You could coach it and do a lot like that. And we're actually launching in a week our crowdsourcing area for coaches. So we have some ex-NHL athletes. Think of it Cameo for sport,
yeah,
right?
Of course, yeah.
Reach out. So that's kind of what we've done is we're trying to democratize sports tech in that sense. Cause you guys, like, how expensive is it now?
Skates. Yeah. Yeah. 100%.
$1,300, man. So what we're trying to do is democratize the sport tech because sport tech's too expensive as well. And hopefully we can get it out there to as many kids, coaches, and parents as well. And, get it going around and see if they enjoy it.
So that's clever.ai. In the
yeah,
App Store?
It's on the App Store and yeah, App Store right now, klevr.ai.
So do you think if me and Obi, you know, get the app and go to the golf course today, we could fucking film a couple of our bad shots and then send it to you to critique it or what?
100%. You could do it in a second. And that's yeah. How golfers are using it, man. So they'll go a whole hole and you can record a whole hole, right? You take your drive, your
see
second
Obi
shot,
fucking
your chip,
fluff
your
it
putt.
Up over in the rough. Eh?
I know. Never so fluffer.
You'll get
Obi. I only fluff in the shower, Steger. I only fluff in the shower.
But you guys, so then you could like take those like little 2-3 second clips of each shot. You could merge it together and now you have your whole hole, right? And then the golf coach can go through all each shot at the hole in one little video. So it's only like an 8 second video. It's super, it's streamlined. Yeah. Basically,
and
right?
You just open the door. You're going to have Upshaw's whole fucking round here in about an hour and a half. He's going to say the whole thing.
I might have to start a TikTok after this too. I might be able to like that shortened version, all the good shots.
There's actually, we would love to see you post to our public feed. We got a public feed. Similar to TikTok in that sense, where you can flip through like content of goals and golfers and everything. Yeah, we'd love to see an uppy hole going.
I can only imagine you, Steger, on the back having to videotape Steger's back check. Hey, back in Florida, fuck. Where is he? He's not on the camera anymore. He's fucking down in the half wall still. He's waiting for a fucking biscuit.
Dude, I got a great story about that in Red Deer. This is like before video was ever a thing. Brent Sutter pulls me into the room. And I'm a defenseman, right? I played D as a 19-year-old.
Wow.
And he's like, watch the tape. So he puts in the VHS and he's like, watch the tape, right? And the video, like I lead the forecheck and then the video comes back and it's in the D zone. And he's like, start fucking counting. I'm like, 1, 2, 3. And he's like, and then you start to see me slowly come back into the video. And he's like, it took you 6 seconds just to come into the fucking video. And he's like, you're a defenseman. He's like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm going for a breakaway. And he's like, man, yeah.
Start counting.
Oh, it's Sutter Brothers. We I don't know if you've seen on our Missin Curfew lately, but our boy Princey's been posting a couple of the fucking of Daryl's videos. It's just awesome. The guy's the 1A in post post game interviews, fucking rates. So
his stuff's hilarious.
Yeah, Steger, man, thank you for doing this. And hey, keep using your platform, buddy. You're good for hockey. You're good for everything right now. So keep it going. I really appreciate you coming on here, taking time out of your day to do this. So Uppy, thanks for getting them, and thank you, Steger.
Yeah, thanks, Steegs.
For sure. Take care, guys.
See you, brother.
Updog, thank you to Theo Fleury and Kris Versteeg. You know, Theo's a passionate guy about it, right? Yeah. And you know, he's been through a lot in his life, on and off the ice. He's battled some adversity. But at the end of the day, he loves Canada.
Yeah, he loves Canada.
And I love Canada, and you love Canada.
He loves people. He loves people.
Yeah, and yeah. Steger loves Canada. And that's all this was. You know, so we didn't want to offend anybody or anything like that. We just all love Canada. We have so many people up there that we love that we want to get back to living the Canadian lifestyle that they deserve, that we were lucky enough to live. So thank you, Theo, Steger. And Steger's living it firsthand with kids playing hockey.
Agreed,
and yeah. Like, I mean, listen, we live in California. We're very fortunate to be down here. And maybe some people will say, hey, you guys don't even live in Canada. You guys shouldn't be talking about it. Maybe you're right. Maybe you're not. But at the end of the day, last thing I'm going to say about it, Uppy, is we all love Canada, and that's all. That's all.
Yeah, and I would state this: if you take one thing out of this, if you think what we talked about is completely like offside or conspiracy, I would like to say that mental health is a real thing.
Yeah.
And if you can't understand mental health by listening to a guy like Theo Fleury and what he's been through, and how he, you know, he's battled it, he speaks his mind, he's helped people, you know, he's found it within himself to be a healer, and that's his passion in life right now. That's the message I want to send. If you can't find anything out of this, you know, let's think about everyone who struggles and, you know, our friends who we've either lost through this or family members who deal with this on a daily basis. You know, we hope that we all can get through this because we're human. We love each other. Unity is power. You know, to be free and to be Canadian is a very special and an honored thing. So, you know, we love that.
Well said. And like I said, we're not in Canada, so this is going to come out probably Friday or Saturday, right? For you beauties up there, Saturday night, Hockey Night in Canada, have one for me in the up dog. Look at the Canadian flag. Give it a cheers. Best country in the world. We love it. And that's all this was about, up dog. I love you. Great tarp.
Thanks, Holmes.
Missin Curfew, baby.